What's up, guys? Welcome back to the Dou Yu Cup. It's game two between Dream Gaming and Braveheart on the way, as Bravehearts do have a one-game lead. Looked a little bit shaky, but then put themselves together and just destroyed Dream Gaming in just one Alpha Strike. I'm Mike Lohr, going to be joined by Kefka for this game too. And dude, I'm being told that we actually have a giveaway after this game, which is pretty sweet.
Yeah, so we can lose those rares betting wrong.
I didn't lose anything. You lost everything. You believed in Terrorblade.
Yeah, and I also believed in Dream Gaming, but
it's not too late.
I think they will make a comeback. They just made some minor mistakes last game that cost them a lot. Going for Roche was way too greedy, and it got punished.
All right, well, guys, that raffle is going to be happening after the stream. One viewer, one sub, going to get some random arcanas or something, or mortals rather, not arcanas. Yeah, that's a slight difference, but yeah, that'll be happening after the stream, so be sure to stick around for that. Not exactly sure how it's gonna go down, so it's probably gonna be me fumbling a whole bunch, but hey, you guys might get free items, so sounds like a pretty clean win for you. But we have a draft going on right now. We have a Spirit Breaker Lina opening for Team Braveheart, one stun into another. Pretty classic stuff right there, as Dream first picked the Shadow Fiend.
Dream Gaming going for the Shadow Fiend, and Braveheart immediately going to Spirit Breaker and Lina, which are two great heroes against Shadow Fiend. Spirit Breaker is one of the better heroes to man fight Shadow Fiend. You can charge him, and it's pretty high chance that he doesn't get his Requiem off, which is a majority of his damage. Just the minus damage that the enemies get is pretty big, and Lina just with Aghanim's can tear Shadow Fiend apart, even if he goes for the BKB.
All right, Queen of Pain as well. Not exactly a super resistant hero to this combo either. She could blink away once from the Spirit Breaker, but chasing down for an LSA combo, and Shadow Fiend, Queen of Pain are both pretty fragile heroes, may very well just end up going down straight after that. So Dream Gaming need to grab some stuns. They need to grab stuns that come out as quickly as possible. Need to protect the Shadow Fiend, or whoever's in the mid lane, really. Someone like an Earthshaker would be huge, would pretty much lock down that mid lane completely as far as offensive Radiant power versus the Bravehearts mid lane. So Earthshaker, Rubick, hell, even a Lion, those types of heroes should be high on the priority list for Dream Gaming.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if Team Braveheart gets rid of the Earthshaker here. I think Dream Gaming will pick it themselves, but I would really like if Team Braveheart bans something else and let Dream Gaming have the Earthshaker, and then they can pick the Rubick instantly, and they have a great hero against both Co-op and Earthshaker then, which would be a great move to get an advantage in this draft.
Lycan, Gyrocopter though, going to be taken out from the Dream Gaming side. Really scared about that pushing from Braveheart. Lycan was also banned in the last game, and I mean, it's, I guess, fine to be scared of that hero, but maybe Dream Gaming, I think, giving that one a little bit too much respect. There was one team in this tournament, I don't know if it was Dream Gaming, they would just always ban out the Lycan, but, you know, whatever. I've only seen it once in this tournament. Shaker is going to be banned out with Wyvern as well. Bravehearts, how much aggression are they actually going to go for right now? Because right now they have a whole lot killing potential, not really a whole lot of pushing, so they could even slow this one down and grab a really slow core like a Phantom Lancer if they really wanted to.
Yeah, it could be a pretty good pick. It's risky against Co-op early game, at least you can get killed pretty fast, but didn't decide to go to let them have the Earthshaker. I bet, I guess they're a bit hesitant because they're not really sure what to pick here, and if they have to figure out what to pick third before they let Dream Gaming have their pick, and then they can go for the Rubick. So if Dream Gaming goes for something else, they can get punished kind of hard because the entire prediction became wrong. But not sure what they're gonna go. They should probably pick up a support right here. And Rubick is still an option. It's been very popular here, and I think it would be pretty good, yeah.
Dire team. Now it's charge into Telekinesis, into LSA. Just the amount of stuns, the amount of raw time where Dream Gaming are gonna be locked down is unbelievably high from Team Braveheart. It's not like they don't have damage to capitalize on that on the stuns either. They have enough damage to kill off heroes like Shadow Fiend and Queen of Pain, so Bravehearts are loaded up on CC, and Dream Gaming really don't have any. We've been seeing a lot of Ember Spirit in this tournament, and like I think in this game it looks like Braveheart are pretty well positioned to potentially go for a hero like that if Dream Gaming don't get enough crowd control.
Yeah, it could be a pretty good pick. I'm not sure. I think it's a bit risky though. I don't think any team should pick Ember here. It's Co-op can punish Ember quite a lot if she gets an Orchid. He dies pretty fast from the damage unless he has his armor up before. And Dream Gaming can't afford to pick an Ember here themselves. And so they're probably going to look for support right there. And Disruptor is one possibility. It's pretty good against Spiritbreaker, I mean, and it's okay against Lina. If you're not the one getting lift by Yuris, you can throw the ultimate and stop initiation and maybe kill her. But Dream Gaming went for the Witch Doctor on this position last game, and it's an okay pick here, even though it wasn't the best last game. He did a good ultimate, but it didn't really pay off the hero.
And the cask is even like a little bit slow as far as response to Spirit Breaker. If you charge in, if it's level 3 or 4, it's just impossible to get that cask to connect before the Spirit Breaker connects with his stun first. And with the lean on and a Rubick on the other end, it's you really need a fast stun. So it's going to be an undying for Dream Gaming, actually. Still absolutely no crowd control from them. It's not like Braveheart have a lot of heroes that need CC, but it's not too late for them to grab someone like a Storm Spirit, in which case Dream Gaming need like a Lion as their fourth pick, and I don't know, someone else with crowd control as their fifth. They do have a lot of damage, Dream Gaming, but all that damage is not always going to connect.
Yeah, I think Undying going through this far was pretty surprising. I didn't really think about him, but he's a pretty good pick, and it forces Braveheart to pick some strong safe lane heroes here, because Dream Gaming can pick another strong hero with Undying and go aggressive. I would love to see a Nightstalker or something very similar that can just hunt down these weak heroes of Braveheart in the Rubick and Lina. Plus Juggernaut is a great hero that's very strong safe lane and can punish heroes like Undying and another hero in aggressive dual lane, even if it was something like a Nightstalker.
We already saw the effectiveness of Juggernaut in lane before. He's just immune to anything that the Undying Phoenix combo of last game did to him. And with the spin, he could also, and wait, with just his right-click damage, he could very easily follow up after a charge or any other stun from any other ally and just kill off whoever's stunned. Even if it is a tankier hero like Undying, Juggernaut does have enough damage early on to actually contribute to it. So Braveheart, they're not really going like super off the rails with this draft or anything. They're just drafting nice, solid, safe heroes. And overall, they just have a really nice lineup versus Dream. They will be forced to grab this Lion just to get some crowd control on the board. Lion is a fine hero. He's a little bit clunky, perhaps, but at this point, you just need the stun.
Yeah, you really need some lockdown right here, and having Lion with two stuns, a Hex and a stun, is pretty damn good, even though he gets quite squishy against what Team Braveheart has. They have Spiritbreaker, Lina, and Juggernaut, who all have big nukes, and Rubick has some great steals in Queen of Pain and Lion Ultimate himself, so Lion is quite squishy in this game, but they were kind of forced to pick him, and I understand why.
And they might have to go for a little bit more as well. Right now, looking like Dream Gaming have their mid lane, their safe lane, the Shadow Fiend and the Queen of Pain, the Undying, perhaps off lane, perhaps support. It's going to be a Darkseer to be banned out from the Braveheart side, and for Dream Gaming, their ban is a little bit more difficult. Lina probably going to go towards mid, Juggernaut in the safe lane, Spiritbreaker off. I guess not that difficult, just Braveheart maybe looking for another support, though the flexibility of Lina is really going to throw a wrench in things. Spiritbreaker also to a lesser extent.
Yeah, they're probably going to look to ban a support. Bounty hasn't been touched yet. I wouldn't be too surprised if he's one of the last picks of either of these teams. Both teams has the potential to run him. Team Braveheart is a bit hesitant to pick him. I think it's quite risky against an aggressive dual lane like Undying plus one that Dream Gaming has the potential of doing.
Bloodseeker is going to be the banned out. Haven't seen him at all recently, but he has been a pretty high impact hero in this tournament so far, so I think that's a justifiable ban. You always got to fear the Rubick Lina support or Rubick Spirit Breaker or whatever, than just that random last hero to be thrown in. Team Braveheart do have enough power right now to go for an offensive tri lane. If they want to do that versus Undying, then more power to them. But Bloodseeker is a fine ban, I suppose. But for Braveheart, they have so much flexibility right now. Honestly, they don't really need anything in particular. Whatever they get is probably going to be just fine. They could even go into some of the weirder heroes.
I would love to see an Invoker from Team Braveheart here, but it's quite risky, but it would be very nice to see that hero. It's one of the more fun heroes to watch, and it fits pretty good in this game. He has okay setup for a few of the heroes in his team. He can use Tornado so that Spiritbreaker comes close enough if he times it well. Also, it's pretty good against what Dream Gaming has in general, but it's of course a very risky pick. It's not the most common heroes and not viewed as stable at all.
Do you think Exort Invoker is just inferior to Wex?
It's very situational. I think both can work, and in general, people tend to go Wex right now. It's fits the meta very good, going aggressive, looking for pickoffs. It's pretty strong. But Windrunner gets picked up. It's somewhat similar here, I think. Risk strong mid laner with a range, some range with a range attack, of course, and it's pretty strong. But it's very squishy against Lion and Queen of Pain. So we'll see if he manages to make some work here.
Yeah, she could avoid a lot of damage with that Windrun, but it's not uncommon to see Windranger versus Queen of Pains just get completely outmatched because she can't trade hits as effectively. Reserve Queen of Pain time. Sees the Windrun, she just straight blinks out and is going to be just fine. And if Windranger gets hexed, it's pretty much just all over for her. But yet, with all that being said, Windranger has so much stun backup and is a hero that can just completely snowball out of control if Braveheart hold the front line. And with the Juggernaut Spirit Breaker, that seems like a definite reality. Windranger is just going to be dishing damage 24/7. In Dream Gaming, they are not exactly super tanky. Undying, of course, is, but everyone else, not as much so. We haven't really seen that much Windranger in this tournament as a whole, but still, I think it's a reasonable hero pickup, assuming you have someone who's capable on the hero. That's really where the Windranger becomes a really great hero. A Slardar from Dream Gaming. Okay, the lanes are going to be a little bit awkward. They do have, I guess, double minus armor with the Slardar and the Shadow Fiend, but yeah, I don't know. This Slardar might just get completely chainstunned. He wants to get a Blink Dagger, but he so desperately needs a BKB.
Yeah, very unorthodox pick, but if he can manage to get his Blink and BKB, he could do some amazing work this game. And I really like how Dream Gaming can lane this. I think they're going to go Undying Queen of Pain in a dual offlane and having Lion Slardar as a safe lane. I think they can actually dominate lanes completely if they run it like that, and Team Braveheart has okay lanes, but they are not that strong.
Well, we'll see. I think this draft is definitely a lot more interesting. Like, we got some flavor in the Slardar and the Windranger hero. Heroes that we don't see all the time. Who do you think has the better draft here?
I think Dream Gaming has the slight edge if they can do good in laning phase, but Braveheart has the more stable ones, I'd say.
Alright, yeah, I think I'm kind of inclined to deal with Eugene Gaming. Have so much upside here, but it's just a matter of cracking into that upside and actually getting value out of it. By the way, Braveheart, they're going to be playing on the Radiant. They got Shur playing the Spirit Breaker. Windranger is there. Chan Chan is going to be playing the Lina with a hell of a lot of regen. We got Rubick as well, and that leaves Chaiyue once again playing the Juggernaut.
Yeah, on Dream Gaming, the names are... Yeah, we have, okay. And Lion, Icy. Gonna put our aggressive ward, I think, here. They want to shut down the Spirit Breaker maybe in lane. And Undying, played by Io. Undying, go aggressive here with the Queen of Pain, played by Ad. And Yixing in the mid lane on Shadow Fiend.
You know, when Queen of Pain's hiding, are they... As Juggernaut, do you really want to go for this? It's... You're kind of safe because you have the spin, but... Is that really worth it? The CC isn't in this bottom rune area, but Chaoyue, he's thinking about it, man. You could tell. He really wants to go in. See Shadow Fiend. Shadow Fiend level 1 is not a threat, but 3
top
heroes
lane.
Level 1. That's a threat. Up towards top. Oh, man. They went on the Lion, who was also deciding to go in. Up against a charge and the variety of CC. That was the wrong decision.
Yeah, good start for Braveheart here with the first blood. And Lina's gonna be top with Spirit Breaker, so they are reacting to this dual lanes in a way. I'm not really sure what they were thinking. They're gonna get a great reward here already. And Dream Gaming is gonna react pretty good, I think. Sending Undying top pair instead of having the dual lane on bottom. Queen of Pain will do pretty damn good on bottom lane, I think. I think he will have almost even farm with Juggernaut, unless Rivik makes some good pull throughs.
And with this Undying now arriving in this top lane, this becomes a much, much better lane for Dream. Up before then, if it's just Slardar and Lion versus Lina Spirit Breaker, I would say Lina Spirit Breaker even have an edge, simply because Slardar is such an awkward hero in this lane, and level 1 crush is nothing to write home about. But Undying is going to make this a firm win for the Dream Gaming side. Bravehearts, I don't see them doing well right now, especially if they go aggressive right now. Chan Chan is going to get stunned. However, the slowdown on the NJ with the charge in, Chan Chan's still taking an absolute beating and will be forced to salve. And well, Dream Gaming, they don't lose any HP from that. They lose a marginal amount of mana. That's a small taste of the power of this lane. Yeah, sure, can maybe survive, but Chan Chan definitely will not.
Nope. I wonder how Undying will skill this. Some people really like going Soul Rip level 2 to have extra bursts, which I think would be a great option in this lane. And bottom lane, Queen of Pain just manning up against Rubick. Rubick has to be careful. The Shadow Strike and auto attacks from Queen of Pain are pretty damn high, and Without Juggernaut being able to really do anything against the Queen of Pain, it's gonna be tough for him in this lane.
He, even if he gets a telekinesis, can only have so long to actually right-click Ad, so he's going up against a lane that can't really kill him unless Ad really, really screws up, and that's kind of the same thing for top lane. Dream Gaming should not die unless they really screw up. So bottom lane, top lane, going pretty well for Dream initially. Mid lane, it's probably going to stay about this even for, throughout the entire laning phase. Shadowfiend already with a couple of souls to his name. And Windranger, yeah, she's decent in lane, but she's not going to crush a Shadowfiend.
Nope, it's going to be tough for Windrunner in mid. Shadowfiend's probably going to dominate this lane. It's very good for Shadowfiend that the lanes are so passive. Like, there are dual lanes on both teams, so it's not easy to rotate in mid. And that's going to favor Shadowfiend in most cases.
Top lane, they're so close to one another. They see, sure, but going in on a Spirit Breaker, even with Tombstone, it's a risky proposition. Similarly, going towards Undying is incredibly risky from Braveheart's side. Chan Chan getting a little bit close. There's no Slaughter here, but oh, that'll show Icy. Take that Dragon Slave to the face.
Gonna see some action in mid lane. Rubick doing a smoke gank here. It's really important that they can manage to get a kill on Shadowfiend, but I'm not sure if he's gonna fall for it. They can throw him into... Yeah. It's not even gonna be close, it was way too far away
top.
There.
Chan Chan's gonna get stunned twice, he's gonna get the LSA out, but with the zombies on him, plus the lion, that's gonna be a kill on the Lina. Sure, also is slowed down, but he'll be fine to walk out of here. Yeah, just the Slaughter arriving a lot faster than I'm sure the Lina anticipated, and I didn't expect the Slaughter to arrive in that time frame either, but with Sprint and with Boots, yeah, you can very easily do that. The failed gank onto Jixing is gonna mean that he's gonna hold control of this lane, fairly even as far as the levels are concerned, but lots more CS for the Shadowfiend. Across the board, going much better for Dream Gaming, and the mid lane, or the mid game scaling is gonna make it a lot more difficult for Bravehearts to come back into this game without some really nice ganks.
Yeah, and that Rubick rotation costs a lot. This Queen of Pain is almost the same loss as Juggernaut because of Rubick not being there, and the range versus melee tends to go favorable for the range hero, and they really need to somehow stop this Queen of Pain right now. She's gonna be able to become a strong core hero in this game.
Yeah, Bravehearts have so much CC, and Queen of Pain should not really be farming this comfortably because she should be scared about all that CC, but putting the Lina and Spirit Breaker up towards top, like, that's the stun combo. And even if they land the stun combo on the Slaughter, that will not directly kill him off. It'll drop him low for sure, but he has crushed disengage straight after with the salve and a lot of regen left. Killing off NJ just seems like a pipe dream at this point, whereas for killing off the Queen of Pain, that's a lot more possible. Should they land a single stun, they're going to land everything else, and Queen of Pain is a lot more fragile than a Slaughter.
Yeah, and Slaughter not farming perfectly. He has a lot of pressure on him, but he's still doing good enough. And now Lina is going to rotate down, and she's spotted instantly by the creeps. And Queen of Pain is going to get lifted either way.
You know what? That lift should not have happened. No. Queen of Pain is going to drop. Like, she should have seen everyone coming, right? Like, I'm not crazy about that. That's vision enough. It is nighttime, I suppose. Windranger gonna get double raised, gets a shackle shot out, so she will not die, but it's a good rotation there from the Braveheart side. Just what I was talking about, just at the proper time as well.
A greedy play from Queen of Pain. She didn't want to waste 60 mana. She rather risk her own life, and it got punished. Smoke from Dream Gaming. They're gonna wrap around here and try and kill the Spirit Breaker, which is getting a lot of creeps on his tower, so they can dive pretty safely.
Rush is there, they have a Tombstone, they're blocking off his escape. He's going to try to cast that charge, but he gets hexed. Spike is still available. They'll use that with a follow-up stun, even getting a bash for good measure. Although that was completely unnecessary, Spirit Breaker really didn't have an escape there. So a successful tower dive, a pseudo-tower dive there from Dream Gaming, now putting a lot of hurt into this top tier 1. No real pushers on the Dream Gaming side, so killing this tower is going to be a little bit difficult, but Shackle lands over in mid, freehand, the LSA is going to follow, and Bravehearts, point blank, power shot, no, just the focus fire instead. Jixing is going to turn around and try to go for Chan Chan, however he can't get the third raise to land, and he will lose his life. A great gank there from Braveheart, and off of freehand Shackle to boot, that's not an easy feat.
Yeah, also a really Dyer's big kill, and shutting down Shadowfiend a bit. He's currently top in, lost it, and that made the Windrunner come top him in network instead, which is pretty damn big, and with a double damage here rotating top, he could maybe get a kill on bottom lane though.
Oh yeah, they're gonna get into a fight with the Queen of Pain, but again, with only one stun being there and not enough mana for an Omni Slash, you will cleanly get out. Lift into the Omni Slash will get you a kill most of the time, but still Windranger is in the area and is still Is she spotted? I don't know if this dire observer near the tower spotted her, but now she is. Shackle gonna land once again. Charges there, and there's no crush in time. However, they can't really go for that one. They have to worry about this tombstone. Sure, he's alone right now. He's gonna get a little help from the LSA, but he's still fighting even through this tombstone. He's only level 2 at this point. Will be destroyed for a little bit of extra cash for Bravehearts. Dream Gaming, though, don't have any casualties, so I think that's probably the best they could have hoped for.
Yeah, it was a pretty even exchange. Taking some damage on mid tower though. Shadow Fiend pressuring when Windrunner is gone is pretty good. But this Queen of Pain is getting quite a lot now. She forced both heroes on bottom lane to go back to base and regen, and she's having a free lane here, which is very good for her.
Level 6, 7 minutes in for any offlane hero is where you want to be and then some. It's a lot further than where you can reasonably expect your offlane hero to be. She will base right now, and lane will be kind of equal, but again, the fear is now going to be a little bit more potent as there is an Omni Slash on the other end. So lift up into an Omni Slash, and though you may have a blink, it's not going to save you versus that lift, assuming, you know, you're not with any creeps. So yeah, the lane is going to get potentially a little bit more difficult for Queen of Pain, but still, the fact that she does have level 6 means that she can rotate around, just drop a Sonic Wave on the top lane or anyone who's in the mid lane and get away with a little bit of ganking.
Yeah, Lina tried to rotate mid, but a good ward from Dream Gaming made sure that Shadow Fiend could play it safe and just wait until she left. And it looks like Shadow Fiend is going to go for the Yules with a Sage Mask pickup and a pause, and Undying will probably go for the mech instead.
It's going to take Undying quite a long time to actually get that, but again, better late than never. For Bravehearts, I don't think anyone is actually going to be going for a mech at all. At least none of these heroes typically build it. So, yeah, they will have that mech advantage eventually in this game. And Yule Scepter versus the softer heroes of Braveheart, killing off a Windranger with Yule Scepter, that's big game. Same thing for Rubick and Lina, though Juggernaut Spiritbreaker a little bit more difficult, still possible. Like, when you could take out the enemy mid laner instantly like that as Shadow Fiend, that's just huge. And getting rid of just another stun at minimum is going to be pretty sweet.
Yeah, and I want to see what Windrunner decides to build, if she's going to go for the Aghanim's play or if she's going to go for something different. Some people like the 4 stuff, but in general you go with when you're facing heroes like Clockwork, then it's kind of necessary to have a 4 step early, but a bottom lane, yeah, she got killed in about half a second.
I think only one of those slashes actually landed, but with the Lina there, then you don't need the entire Omni Slash lane. So Queen of Pain getting way too comfortable over towards mid. Windranger taking a couple of raises, won't take the third one, and that wouldn't have been lethal anyway, but still flirting with death right now as she's kind of just taunting the Shadow Fiend up towards top. Sure, Amplify damage is now up, Fortify not available. Chan Chen gonna throw a Dragon Slave over too. Not bad value there, but if she gets hexed, she's just dead. Oh man, they're once again flirting with death. Top lane tower will drop in exchange for perhaps this bottom lane tier 1, yet it will be an even tower trade after all is said and done. So we're across the board fairly even, but Queen of Pain dying there, she is, you know, getting a lot out of this lane, which is good for her, but that also makes dying hurt that much more.
Yeah, she had a very good start, but has gotten killed 2 times now, and she's gonna have a problem surviving in this fight. She's quite squishy as a hero if she doesn't get the necessary farm, and it might be in a case she has to just go in, blow her RL spells, and then die and hope that the team can clean up.
Kind of like a clockwork, just YOLO in and put everything up and hopefully you don't die, except she doesn't have the survivability of that hero. They're going to smoke up and they're going to run to Chaoyue. The Observer Ward is going to see the pull. Chaoyue is going to see Icy right now. Where's the hex? Sleeping. Okay, well, Lion missed that one. They clean up the stack, or the pull rather, which is nice, but they could have had themselves a Juggernaut. They might have themselves a Rubick instead. As Ad, I think, is spotted by the tower. So no more surprises there, as Rubick is going to cower in a corner. We'll be just fine up towards top, however. Laguna Blade onto the Slardar. He didn't sprint, but still the damage is there. No Nether Strike even needed, and Slardar left alone is going to be very quickly dropped.
Big kill. Slardar was getting closer and closer to that blink. It looked like it was going to rush at least, and shutting him down gives Braveheart quite a lot of time to get a few more items up before that initiation can happen from him.
It's a little bit of pressure towards this bottom tier 1, but it's not exactly enough to make Bravehearts really scared and, you know, rotate a whole mess of heroes down here. Like, they're still just jungling away with the Juggernaut in top lane. They're pushing in there as well. Even if Dream Gaming want to go for a push on this bottom lane, I don't really know if it's worth their time, just because it is so damn slow.
It's taking a lot of time, and they're not doing any damage at all. Slara is rotating down, though, but it's not a very strong hero without the blink. He needs that kind of mobility, and he's not tank either because he doesn't go for something like a Vanguard. So he doesn't have something to make up for it. And they really want to dive this Rubick, but I think the entire team of Braveheart is going to TP here, or he's just going to get out. Attack.
They have no spike in range, no crush in range either. Tombstone gets dropped to destroy some trees, but now Icy is inconveniently behind the tower. It doesn't matter because they will have enough to just brute force it down at this point. But Rubick got level 6 while he was just cowering behind that tower. And top lane, it is going to be pushed successfully by the Braveheart side. They're going to try to go for G-Sting. There's a Shackle potential here. No, actually, she already threw it, so never mind. Omnislash would have gotten the kill otherwise, but it's just a tier 1 Radiant to fall. And then maybe a little bit more aggression towards mid, as they're just going to tank the tower with that healing ward. G-Shing can't really do that much about it, except for throw a raise and try to thin the creep wave, but there is no creep wave, so that's not a plan. Focus Fire is going to destroy this tower really quick, and Dream Gaming, not reinforcing fast enough, are going to lose this one in even trade again. Here comes a TP, it's the Queen of Pain, and they do have a Blink Dagger on Slaughter now, so now's the time for Dream Gaming to potentially fight, especially when Slaughter's in a really good position right now with the high ground. Healing ward's just about to time out, and it will. But Bravehearts, no, I don't know if they're going to go in here. It's a little bit risky to push into the tier 2s, even if you have no plans on taking it.
Yeah, a lot of heroes gathering here in mid, but it looks like Braveheart will take the tower and just get out and farm the enemy jungle, which is pretty efficient. A lot of towers trade, but favoring Braveheart with one extra tower taken, and they still have their mid tower there. Smoke from Dream Gaming, not sure if they will try and go for the Rosh. They have amplified damage, but they might find the Spirit Breaker instead.
Well, you can get both, right? Like, they see the Spirit Breaker, he's gonna get Blink Crush. It is going to reveal the Blink Dagger on Slardar, which is kind of unfortunate for the Dream Gaming side, but hey, he has a Blink Dagger, and that should be making them happy enough. Now with the Amplified, they'll go straight in, and we might see this classic Tier 2 top lane for Roshan trade, although at this rate, well, maybe if Slaughter had a TP scroll, they could actually like clear the Roshan, get back up to top, and defend that objective as well. But hey, it's a Roshan for tier 2. No, neither Tide is going to be super unhappy to make this trade.
Oh, it's pretty standard, like I mentioned earlier. And Aegis to Slaughter is going to mean he can be a lot more aggressive. This hero is somewhat squishy if he goes too deep in with Sprint, giving him so he takes more damage. But going to be able to pick up a bit more tankiness with Power Threads probably, and Aegis makes it can make so that he can dive pretty deep with Lina only having one Laguna Blade, so he can't die twice to that.
The supports though, they're going to post up, find G-Shing, lift him up into an LSA, Laguna Blade plus a Dragon Slayer. Charge is going to jump over to AO, Sonic Wave flies through into two, that's going to kill off the Rubick and Chan towards the after. Shackle's going to fly, will connect, but now this Windranger just has to leave. Crush will land! And that's going to kill off the Windranger as well with the spike in. Dream Gaming lose their Shadow Fiend, yes, but get a hell of a lot in exchange. And Bravehearts, I mean, the Windranger arriving there, usually you're going to be fine as Windranger, but not that time.
No, a very greedy play killing the Shadow Fiend. It looks very good, but Queen of Pain coming in at the perfect time and getting a great ultimate off on both heroes that were there. And a bit lucky managing to kill the Windrunner as well. Slaughter managing to get there in time and stop the TP out.
Well, Dream Gaming going to try to ride this Aegis into a couple more objectives. Tier 1 tower, fortifiable, will be used right now. Fortified. And Blink, Crush, well, it's going to be held for right now. He's going to get lifted up. Is there enough damage right now? Nether Strike should just instantly kill him off. Gets Soul Ripped. Will survive for a little while longer. Gets the Crush. Sprinting out now. Will lose the Aegis regardless. And Juggernaut also does Omnislash kill off the Juggernaut with the kill off the Undying. Now the LSA nowhere close to connecting from Chan Chan, yet still a lot of damage to NJ. Sure takes the Finger of Death to the face. Will get raised down. Xiaoyue still sticking around right now. They have Windranger quickly incoming. Chan Chan, Laguna Blade onto NJ. Will kill him off with the Dragon Slave. There's Requiem. Will kill off the Spirit Breaker and the Rubick both. Chan Chan will also fall. Two man Shackle though from the Windranger. Way too late to this party. At least for Bravehearts, they keep their cores alive. It's a 3-for-3 if you count the Aegis, but still Dream Gaming get away with a pretty nice win.
Yeah, it was pretty good for Dream Gaming. It was really close to the Slaughter survived. He was just about to crush the Lina, and I think she would have died pretty much instantly, but she got the Laguna Blade off and managed to get that trade at least. But yeah, the Dream Gaming is not going to be able to take the tower, so that's very good for Braveheart, with the Windrunner running Midas, actually, to try and outfarm the opponents.
It's not a terrible item, and it's already kind of kicking into gear. We see that with the Mithril Hammer already in her person. Probably a Lightning Hammer for the Windranger to get that damage up, and then an Aghanim's shortly after. At least that would be what I imagine the build should be for her, but outside of that, they still have the Yule Scepter slowly being built up on the Lina. Chaoyue just picked up a Yasha with the Mask of Madness. He's not doing too bad either. Dream Gaming, yeah, they have the Blink Dagger on the Slardar, which is going to make him an active hero, but you really need to get some action going with this hero once you do grab that Blink, if you want to do a good job overall in the game.
Yeah, he's not very farmed at all. Bottom 5, actually, in terms of Nepper on the Slardar. And he's gonna have trouble in this game. There's a lot of damage on Braveheart's side, even just from Lina can actually take him down very low. And with a Juggernaut ultimate as well, if he gets caught in that, he's dead pretty much instantly. And there's no mech to save him yet, and Undying is quite far away from it.
Bottom lane, Rubick just looking for a spell to steal, but now we'll have to face up against the fish. Will Blink, Crush, Amplify, Queen of Pain jumps in as well, and that's the death of the Rubick. At least for Bravehearts, everyone else already left that area, so they're not going to lose anyone else, but still, they do smoke up, kill the Rubick, and now they're going to try to go for a tier 2. They failed to take the tier 1 with their entire team earlier, going for a tier 2 push, this time without Aegis. Seems awfully risky to me.
Yeah, I'm not sure if they'll go for it. Braveheart are split pushing very well, actually. Putting a lot of pressure on the mid tower and Windrunner are pressing top as well. So I think Dream Gaming has to fall back and defend its lanes. And some core items. Lina very close to Yules. Actually, I think she has it on the courier. Yeah, that's very big. That could be a very good counterization to Slaughter, who will probably die very fast if he gets Yules up.
And even if he like blinks in, gets the crush on Lina, it doesn't seem like he has enough damage to instantly kill her off, so she could just Yules and run away at that point. If she wants to use it purely defensively, that's also something she could do. Mid lane tower is going to be the objective after all for Dream. They are not spotted right now. There's a whole bunch of sentries here for the Radiant, but no, they catch the line anyway. LSA will connect. Ice is going to lift up. Power shots there as well as Laguna Blade. My god, that's a dead lion. Is that worth using all of that for? I don't really know, but Cher's going to arrive onto Ao. He's not in a good position right now. Spirit Breaker has no support here. That was an awkward angle. I thought he was coming from the fountain, in which case, yeah, that would have been retreatable, but not in that place, man. Not in that place. Tower will also be destroyed by the Queen of Pain, so it is a one-for-one trade right now. Looking for a Shackle as the Wind Ranger. Won't find it, as everyone else from Dream Gaming will back off.
Mistake from Spirit Breaker charging in there and dying, and he's actually bottom two net worth. He started as an offlaner, but hasn't really had a good game. I'm not sure how the farm went early game, because they were doing some weird lanes, but I think he was supposed to have a bit more farm than this, but Lina having a lot of farm is okay as well, because she has a lot of damage against what Dream Gaming has, and Slaughter is very underfarmed. And he will not be able to tank these spells. I'm not sure how to resolve this problem. They kind of have to just sacrifice him in fights and try and get the best trades. But with Queen of Pain not being the most farm here, she has okay farm, but she really needs Aghanims and one more item before she can really go into these fights as well. It's going to be tough for quite some time for Dream Gaming.
Yeah, for Slaughter, maybe like approach the game kind of like a bounty hunter, where you just look to get in there with the vision. And yeah, if you crush someone, that's great and everything, but I think at this point, the Slardar's objective should not be, I'm going to be doing damage. It should be, can I land a crush on two heroes? He's like a centaur bounty hunter hybrid at this point, where they don't do any right-click damage. They just, you know, throw their skills occasionally and hope to get value off of that. I think if you just rely on the Shadow Fiend more, that's probably where Dream Gaming have to go towards at this point, but it's obviously not where they want to go, especially with a safe lane farming Slaughter. You want him to be smashing things, man. You want him to be sitting in the middle of the fight with the BKB, just wailing on everyone and not dying at the same time, but there's so much damage, as you said, it's so hard for that to actually happen. And that's something that Juggernaut can also do, like that the Slaughter really can't. He could sit there and just, soon with the Mantis style, just go to town on anyone, even dispel the amplified damage from the Slaughter once he gets that item.
And Winner goes for the Blinks. This is a great pickup. I was hoping would go for it, but I wasn't sure. But he gets it, and he has insane killing potential right now. He could actually kill his brother,
yeah,
I think.
Going anywhere. Oh my god, he got like... Well, he's now getting some Lightning Frost, but even with Shadow Fiend there, Yule Scepter Requiem, not quite in range, it seems. And that Slaughter didn't stand a freaking chance, and he's like still one of the tankier heroes. ADD is going to get lifted up in the bottom lane. He's going to get chopped to pieces, and the Tombstone's going to die as well. It's two kills for Braveheart. And it might be a little bit more, since Windranger still has double damage, still has a Shackle. However, Yule Scepter comes out in time. That may save the Shadow Fiend, but still, she's going to try to go for it, just their sheer damage. It does get rid of that double damage rune, and Icy's right around the corner. Power Shot's going to fly. G-Shing can take a lot of damage, but Bravehearts, they will back off with the Windranger. But still, bottom lane's a clean win for them. Top lane, this Windranger is being an absolute menace, and they might go for AO as well. Lift him up into an LSA. Undying's going to fall in the exact same way as the Queen of Pain. And the TP is cancelled even, so that's a lot of free time for Bravehearts to take this tower. This is starting to feel like game one, where it's fairly even for so long, then a couple of mistakes, and then things get out of control.
Suddenly Braveheart just taking complete control, killing people everywhere and getting that tier 2 and also a lot of damage on the tier 3 tower. Amazing play from this Windrunner. She goes on Shadow Fiend, very close to killing her, but blinks out right in time. I think if she had gone for half a second more, Lion would have came in and killed her together with Shadow Fiend Races. So very good presence of mind from that Windrunner.
Yeah, playing it safe, but still being an absolute threat. She's going to go for the Aghanim Scepter, so you know, I'm pretty sure next time, if she is going to find herself a situation where she trades Shackle Shot for Yule Scepter, the advantage of having the Focus Fire is going to tip things into her favor, and even the Spirit Breaker maybe going to join that fray as well. But for Dream Gaming at this point, they know that if they send one hero up to this top lane to deal with this Windranger, it won't be enough. They have to send two, and one of those two has to be either Slaughter or Lion. They have to have some form of CC to actually lock her down to kill her. I guess Shadowfiend Yule Scepter at this point is good enough as well, but still, this Windranger can do like Broodmother things up on the top lane, just constantly sit up there, constantly push in and threaten kills. And for Dream Gaming, they don't really have an effective way to one versus one the Windranger, so they have to commit two heroes up to the top lane. While the rest of the team for Bravehearts, they're doing everything else everywhere else. Unfortunately,
Yule's from Lina
is going to run into a whole mess of heroes, but at the same time, yeah, they're going to try to go for Jisheng. Requiem, though, will pop the Rubick. No, it won't. He stole Blink. He's going to take no damage from that. That's a BKB charge used, yet they're still doing a lot of damage to this double damage rune. Blink forward, crush, will be canceled by an LSA, and now this Rubick trying to hide. He will blink straight over and through the Queen of Pain. Is he really going to survive this? He shouldn't. Chan Chan is also on the run with Yule Scepter. He'll be just fine to slip out of there. I can't believe they actually got away with both of those heroes.
Yeah, slightly mistimed use into Requiem of Souls from the Shadow Fiend, costing him a 10-second BKB charge as well as not getting kill of Rubick. And Juggernaut died meanwhile, I didn't really catch that. Not sure how.
Walked right into four heroes.
Yeah, also a big mistake, but Winona putting so much pressure here on the top lane as well. He's not gonna be able to do any damage, but if he realizes where Dream Gaming are, he might be able to know. He's just gonna farm his jungle. He could have gone a lot damage there in the trade of Roche.
Close to even just destroying that tower, but instead it's going to be Slaughter to grab that double life, so he can once again just go in and go ham. But where will they actually go? Because tier 2 towers are the only remaining objectives here for Dream Gaming, and even though they have a lot of minus armor, none of that minus armor actually applies to the buildings, or at least not yet, no AC or anything like that, so going for tier 2 is a little bit more difficult for Dream, and they haven't really had a good track record with pushing either way, and now Bravehearts, they're going to be smoking up. And they may run into two heroes if they go towards mid a little bit closer. If Ad shows his face, he's just dead. Or if they kill off Jisheng right now, that opens the door for a push. The Windranger's playing it cool right now. They have a Yule Scepter trying to force out a BKB perhaps, or just straight Amistash. No, Yule Scepter's there. He gets lifted up in exchange. There's the Laguna Blade. Kill off the Shadow Fiend immediately. Now onto NJ, they're going to try to go. Netherstrike's going to connect actually with a bash. They'll take down the Aegis Spike a little bit too late there from Icy. And at this point, they can't do anything to help, although they're going to try. Tombstone's down the deck. Yule Scepter on. This Slaughter right now is ADD, just throw in the Sonic Wave towards the Rubick, but they're still doing a lot of damage towards everyone right now. Shura's gonna charge right through three. The Windranger again with the Focus Fire is gonna go straight towards the Slaughter, who is not sprinting, but still taking a lot of damage. Shura's taking all the damage in the meantime for the Braveheart side. That's the perfect focusing, for Bravehearts rather. Icy's gonna get blinked upon and will get dropped. Double kill for Chan Chan. And Dream Gaming, they had an Aegis there, but that second reinitiation, that was a bad move.
Yeah, so good play from Braveheart. They're so far ahead as well. They're really utilizing the heroes well, and the only damage Dream Gaming has is Shadow Fiend or Queen of Pain's spells, but with Shadow Fiend dying instantly, there's not really that much they can do. They managed to pick up the kill on Rubick, but that's all, and it's gonna be Rex for sure, and the advantage for Braveheart is huge, even though Dream Gaming got the Roche earlier.
Quick sprint. And the Focus Fire from Dream just not really up to snuff, but even if it was a little bit better, like, they walk away with, what, one more kill, probably, and that's definitely not going to be enough to salvage what just happened. The Windranger should have her Aghanims completed, and she does, so she just skyrocketed in her kill potential. Plus, having a BKB on Lina lets her sit comfortably in the middle of those fights. Yeah, the physical right-clicks with the minus armor is kind of threatening, but if it's only the Shadow Fiend, if he's the first one to die and he was in the last fight, then there's not that much to be scared of at that point. So Bravehearts taking melee racks, that of course means ranged racks, will soon follow just with the creep wave pushing in as it normally happens. Dream Gaming have no more Aegis now. That was a fight that they should have either avoided completely and accepted their loss of the Shadow Fiend, or they should have won. But since it's neither, now they're in an awkward position where they don't really have any objective to go for.
Finally, Lion picking up the Blink though. That's their saving grace right now. That's they had to rely on Lion to follow up Slaughter and try and get at least 2 kills before the fight really starts. But the damage from Braveheart is so high. This Windrunner can solo kill anyone in a Shackle. Also, Lina with the BKB now, she can be insanely aggressive. And she can won't die unless Slaughter pokes her. That's the only way she will go down. And Juggernaut with Omnislash can just tear apart everyone on Dream Gaming right now.
It feels like the two big threats, the two redheads, the Windranger, the Lina, they're the ones packing serious heat. But like the Juggernaut also, as you said, he's like kind of playing it a little bit quieter. The Omnislash is definitely a potent threat, but he's not getting to the I'm just going to right-click you to death stage that Juggernauts usually want to get to just yet. He has Mantis Style, Mask of Madness, which is by no means bad, but the fact that this Juggernaut, who is very, very farmed, doesn't feel like a threat or as big of a threat as he really should is really troubling, because that just shows how much more threatening the rest of the Braveheart side is. Like, they even have a Blink Dagger on Rubick, so I guess matching the Lion's Blink Dagger one for one, pretty much every single hero on Braveheart has what they need, exception perhaps being the Spirit Breaker, but he's pretty close to his BKB as well.
Yeah, and no smoke ready for Dream Gaming yet, so they can't go for that and try and get a big fight to maybe get a comeback in this game, so they have to wait for that. But an Invis on Shadowfiend might be exactly what they need. They can't really go for the Juggernaut though, he can easily spin off the Yules.
Yeah, Yixing not gonna even try to break his Invis on that hero. The illusions Dyer's from the Juggernaut will not attack. Scout out anyone, it seems, but still up towards top. Windranger doing some damage there, forces AO back, and hell, she could have even gone for that kill if there was an angle, but there wasn't, so she will play it safe and back off. No sense dying there as Windranger, but still, like, the split push on top lane is real. It's forcing Dream Gaming into a situation where they always have to be keeping an eye on top lane, keeping teleportation scrolls as well, and then at that point, if Bravehearts get, you know, good LSA, good charge through, cancel a couple TPs, then it could be suddenly tier 4s in trouble from the top lane. It's not going to be a prime objective for Windranger to do that, but just the options and the damage that she has enable that to happen.
Yeah, objective gaming from this Windrunner. I wonder if she's going to move to bottom lane. She could pretty fast take down the tier 3 tower there. It's very low already, so she can actually just take that down manually and then use Focus Fire to take down Rex very fast. But they're going to go for smoke, and this could be a really good play with Dream Gaming being out of position right there.
Omnislash is leading the way. Chai Wei also has a fresh BKB, and they find three heroes right now. Yule Scepter on the Shadow Fiend. BKB gets used in the Juggernaut. Will just instead decide to spin out. Sure, does get the Nether Strike on Jixing with the Windranger's damage. The Yule Scepter off the Shadow Fiend once again. Now the Omnislash is there. That'll annihilate the Queen of Pain, jumping up to the Undying as well. They buy back with the Queen of Pain. They do lose the Spirit Breaker on the Radiant side, but Ayo, he's going to get brought down by Chan Chan's burst damage. Lift up on NJ. He'll get dropped as well. Rekkon for the low ground, doing some decent damage, but now the Tombstone is down. They could go forward for more as Bravehearts. Windranger going to go straight for this line. Will dodge the spike. But it's going to be a 3-for-1 after all is said and done. With the healing wards kicking in, Braveheart can go for this tier 2 push while being at full health. It's a clean victory for them.
Yeah, it's a good fight from Dream Gaming, really, but Braveheart are so far ahead. There's nothing Dream Gaming can really do. They blew up Spirit Breaker really good with Slaughter and Pop Ultimate, but they're so far ahead on Braveheart with everyone having the core items up, a lot of BKBs ready, and the damage is just way too much for them to handle with only a mech into their defensive.
And also the Windranger in that fight was under no pressure whatsoever. Like, she was not taking any damage at all. And they're gonna get lift up onto Icy. That's a dead line right there, with Chan Chan grabbing a mega kill off of that. Charge is coming in from the base, so Spirit Breaker will arrive. They're looking for a Shackle. That was pretty ambitious from the Windranger. Not gonna land, but the melee racks will fall regardless of that fact. If Dream Gaming can't get to the backline and get onto this Windranger, then what the hell are they going to do about her? Like, there is no other option. You gotta kill this Windranger. She's doing so much damage. Okay, they could just tap out. I guess that's their option.
Yeah, some insane reactions from Rubick. They're killing the Lion, and Dream Gaming is too far behind. They're weak. The draft was kind of... It was not too weak, but Queen of Pain needed a better start. She had a great early game, but then she died 2 times, and with Slaughter being this underfarmed, he couldn't really go into the lineup of Braveheart, and it meant Braveheart can just do whatever they want this game, and took every fight very convincingly.
Alright, well guys, that is going to be that. Braveheart stomping every single fight, getting an out-of-control Windranger, a super farmed Juggernaut, and even Alina, who's not going to fall behind either, and Slaughter didn't really do that much. Unfortunate, because whenever I see these picks, I'm always like, wow, I want to see this hero win so we can see more of him in the future. It's not going to be the case this game, unfortunately. Guys, we're done here for today. I'm Mike Grossman, joined by Kefka. If you did enjoy the games, then be sure to hit the follow button down below to follow the stream. Follow me at Mike Loris on Twitter. Follow him at Kefka Dota, on Twitter as well. And, of course, follow Hefka TV on Facebook and Twitter. We have a giveaway, which will be coming up in just a couple of minutes. One sub is going to be winning one Immortal. One viewer is also going to be winning one as well. So you have, like, 1 out of 47 or whatever versus 1 out of 15. So, yeah, something does increase your odds, I guess. But you got to stick around for that. So don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be getting to that very shortly. Later, guys.